So I just finished playing Nancy Drew Midnight in Salem. Here are my initial impressions of the game. Overall, I'd say it's a decent enough game. I'm glad I played it, but there were definitely some problems with the game. I think the main problem is the graphics, which everyone complained about in the trailer. The background graphics look fantastic, and about half the characters look great. So, you know, Jason Danforth looks good, the Hardy Boys look good, Mae looks good, and then the rest of the characters don't look so good, like Deirdre Shannon and Tegan. They also kind of sway a lot, so they stand like this, and they sway a lot through most of the game, and I just found that kind of distracting. And they were definitely not as detailed as the other characters were, not at all. And I don't want to say they look kind of fake. I think people said Sims 2 was the most common way the characters were described. They just sort of looked kind of low res, especially compared to the Hardy Boys, who looked fantastic and, you know, awesome. And the problem is Deirdre follows you for a good amount of the game, so you get a lot of seeing Deirdre's face, and it's like, oh, no, no thank you. She actually looked a little bit better in Alibi and Ashes, I would say. If they had just been lazy and reused her character model from Alibi and Ashes, I would have been fine. I think I might have liked that even a little bit better than the Deirdre we saw in this game, who's just sort of blocky and, you know, moved in a very strange fashion. So, you know, that's kind of a problem when half the characters in the game don't look so good and don't move so good. Now, I am glad we had a lot of characters in this game. That was very ambitious for them to include so many characters. I thought it was just going to be the standard four characters in this game, but no, we have like nine. And then a bunch of characters moving around in the background. That was great. All the background characters looked fantastic. I especially liked the guy in the sweater near Olivia's place. Sweater guy was fantastic. You know, when I can come up with a name and actually feel empathy for this random background character, that's a good sign. That's some good writing. So, the inventory system I thought was strange. They completely redid it. It's very, some people liked it. They thought it was very stylized and not cluttering up the entire screen. I kind of like having the entire screen cluttered up myself. When I saw the initial screenshots of the game, I thought, oh, well, that's obviously placeholder art. That's not going to be the real finished art. But no, that was actually the finished art, little small white boxes. Instead of like a detailed picture of, say, the flyer or a book, it's just a little outline of a book. And you can click on it, and you can move things in 360 degrees, all directions. That was really cool. I really liked that. I was kind of terrible at it, though. Like, every single piece of paper, I wanted to flip over to see if there's something written on the back side, and I just left, turn. So I had a hard time turning things around to the back side. I don't know, but it was still kind of cool. I miss Nancy's, I miss having that little hint button thing where you can click and you can get more and more hints as it goes on. The game doesn't seem to have any sort of built-in hint system. So if there's a puzzle you're stuck on, you're just sort of stuck on it and need to get help. But there's a task list on Nancy's phone, so that kind of helps. But yeah, I'm not sure we can call Nancy's friends for help. Nancy's friends, you can't call them for hints. So yeah, this game doesn't have a built-in hint system. So I got stuck a couple of times. Yeah, I also got stuck with the movement. Moving around was kind of a problem for me. Especially in the graveyard where, it's like the path splits up into three spots. And so I wanted to go forward or I wanted to go left, but it thought I was clicking on the other one. That happened a couple of times. Partially, I think the problem is with the new navigation system that, you know, the control arrows are different. Now they match the inventory. They're the same little small white arrow as opposed to the big clunky arrows in previous games. I kind of like the big clunky arrows. Hard to mess up when it's big and clunky. Puzzles. There are not too many puzzles in this game, I don't think. I'm trying to remember all the puzzles. Let's see. There's the initial puzzle of moving a square through a maze, and then they were making cakes. That was a puzzle. And then finding all the ravens in town, getting into the evidence room, and then the computer in the evidence. I don't know. I guess maybe there were about like 10 puzzles, but the game seems more dialogue heavy and plot heavy than puzzle heavy. And I'm really a fan of puzzle heavy games. So I really liked, more than other people, I liked Ransom of the Seven Ships and Labyrinth of Lies because I like puzzle-heavy games. Those games have their problems, but I really liked how they had these big puzzle segments. And other people sort of just hated it, but no, man, puzzle segments are my thing. So we didn't really get really puzzle-heavy until the end when there were like three or four puzzles in a row, and that was good. I liked that. The ending segment was definitely good. Except for the final ending segment. Once the puzzles were over, the game continues for about 20 minutes of talking, and that's sort of a problem. This game has too much dialogue, is my initial impression. I'd have to, I imagine when I replay this game, I'll be more used to how much dialogue there is and the pacing, but I was expecting things to be moving more quickly and far less dialogue. So for example, the opening segment of the game, we have this little tutorial segment in this room that we see once and then never again. It reminded me of Alibi and Ashes, because we have a little tutorial intro section in Alibi and Ashes too. Now, the one in Alibi and Ashes, you know, you go into the courthouse, and then you have a puzzle getting out of the room and a puzzle getting out of the courthouse, and then we have this big cutscene and the game begins. And that's sort of, it's sort of the same way here, but there is, I swear, 15 minutes of talking in this room. Nancy can examine these items and have long conversations about them. Like, there was a piece of paper with Psalm 55 on it. Totally not important, never comes up again, but wow, we get to talk about it for 3 minutes, I suppose. And we talk with this Dr. Elizabeth person who never shows up again either. It's very, very strange. So I think if what I would have done is I would have cut out pretty much all the dialogue in the opening tutorial section and just have it be, hi, here's the room, here's your puzzle tutorial, figure out how to open the desk. Oh no, somebody robbed Nancy and stole the book that she wanted. And we have the chase scene, and then we have, the big cutscene where Nancy goes to Salem, where the main game is. Sort of, like I said, like Alibi and Ashes. Just parallel that game where it's like, okay, we have this intro scene, and then bam, cutscene, you're into the main game. And it doesn't help that the first scene we have is basically Deirdre and Tegan, and those are the two characters that look the worst. That wasn't a good way to start off the game. But the Hardy Boys show up partway through. That was cool. I'm not sure what was going on with the Ned drama, because when Nancy first leaves the house, Ned calls, and someone is there with Ned, and he's like, Nancy, and she's like, this girl is on the phone like, Ned, come on, we've got to go. He's like, I'm sorry, Nancy, we've got to leave. Bye, Nancy. And I'm like, what was that about? And I don't think we ever got an explanation. We didn't get an explanation. Maybe I missed it somewhere. But instead, we got Nancy and Ned planning to go on vacation, maybe somewhere in Austria. So it sounds like that was a pitch for the next game in the series. We didn't get a trailer for the next game in the series like we usually do. We don't know what's going to happen next. So that's different. I thought there were like two different, ideas that they were throwing out. Like at the very end, Nancy suggested, let's go back to Austria. We've got this great castle with 1,000 different passageways. But then earlier on when she was talking to Ned, she's like, we need to go on vacation. Like, I thought it was someplace tropical where we can relax. And I'm totally forgetting which Nancy Drew book it is, but there's totally a book where Nancy and Ned just visit the Caribbean. Of course, she's been to the Caribbean multiple times and multiple books, so I don't know. I think it'd be cool if she went on a cruise. We could call it, what was it, the Ship of Shadows, like the Nancy Drew Dozier game. So she could go on a cruise like that. I would be interested in seeing that. So getting back to the actual game, I'd say the dialogue heaviness continues for most of the game. Now, is it better than the dialogue in the Shattered Medallion? Yes! The dialogue in Shattered Medallion makes no sense. It is hard to understand, whereas most of the dialogue in this game makes perfect sense. It sounds like a normal conversation. It sounds fine to me. It's just there's just so much of it. That's all. It's just got a completely different pacing compared to previous games. What about the characters? You know, I like the Hardy Boys. I like Deirdre. Deirdre is always hilarious. I liked how Deirdre and Joe were sort of flirting with each other throughout the entire game. That was great. That actually worked well.
Spoiler warning, everybody. At this point, I start talking about the plot of the game. So if you don't want the storyline spoiled for you, stop watching now.
Oh yeah, sort of the storyline with May, just like 2 hours into the game, May casually mentions, oh, by the way, I've got burns all over my entire side of my body. And that ends up being a plot point. I'm surprised that wasn't mentioned sooner. So I feel like some of the plot points could have been shifted around. Like, we should have learned, hey, May is a burn victim. We should have learned that sort of at the start. May has a history with fire, because that's important to the storyline of figuring out who set the house on fire, right? Yeah, and that's why everybody's suspecting her. It feels strange that these characters weren't telling Nancy the truth from the start. Deirdre should have been upfront with Nancy from the start about May's accident. But, I mean, I knew May is a burn victim because that was in the promotional materials. But I imagine somebody who didn't, you know, follow all the information about the game, it would be a complete shock and surprise. Just like sort of near the ending where Tegan's like, oh, by the way, I was the one who set the house on fire. That was a big shock and surprise too. Just in the middle of an otherwise normal conversation, we're just dropping this huge bomb. So I thought maybe that could have been placed better. Although it was really shocking and surprising because it was part of a normal conversation. It wasn't what you would expect to be a natural confrontation scene. So yeah, I would shuffle some of the information around better. Let's see, the other character. Olivia, I liked Olivia. I thought Olivia could have been done better, but I liked what they were doing with Olivia, where she's just sort of this silly, fun character. I kind of like that. The voice actress did a good job making her seem silly and fun. But then it was kind of strange because she's allegedly supposed to be the same age as all the other characters, and she does not look like she's the same age as all the other characters. She looks significantly older than Tegan and Lauren. So I thought that was strange. I don't know what age the characters are, because we're told Deirdre was babysitting May when May was 9 years old. So how much older is Deirdre than May? Deirdre's like 18, right? Deirdre, Nancy, and the Hardys are all like 18. Frank's 18, Joe is 17. That's the way it is, I imagine, in all the books, because they're all sort of in the same year of high school. Depending on the book, Nancy's sometimes in high school, sometimes she's not. I don't know. So, you know, the fact that Deirdre's maybe a few years older than May makes me think, well, okay, so either Nancy and her friends are like in their late 20s, not late 20s, early 20s. Let's say they're 21 and they've all just finished college. Or all these characters are like 3 years younger than them, so everybody's like 15 or so. And that wasn't really brought up. They didn't talk about like trying May as a child or an adult. So it was sort of like implied that May's an adult. That's something I would have liked to explain. I don't know how old these characters are. Now, other characters, the judge was kind of hilarious too. I like the judge. Oh, the poor judge. That guy does not have all of his marbles together. And I really like the ending when Nancy just totally dug into the judge. Nancy was such a sassy detective and so on fire for justice. Like, no, judge. Hey, Salem has a history of terrible judges bending the law. I don't want to see you do the same thing. And he's like, oh, okay, you're right, Mr. So yeah, I thought the judge was a funny character. Alicia Cole, I hate to say it, but I thought she was the least interesting character. I thought there was really not much going on for her. She doesn't seem to have much of a personality. She has this one random conversation about how she wants to start a family, but she doesn't like any of the guys here, which I think is sort of a strange conversation to be having with Nancy. Like, generally, middle-aged women don't talk with teenagers about life plans and getting married. That's just not something which comes up within 2 minutes of meeting someone for the first time. Yeah, so I thought that was odd. I don't know, maybe Alicia's a completely different age than, maybe she's not middle-aged. Maybe I'm wrong about how old she seems. I don't know, I could be wrong. I liked Jason Danforth, the judge's son, who's just kind of this real stereotype of a sleazy guy who's always hitting on people, and then he's actually just kind of pathetic and wimpy. I really liked... I like seeing him get his comeuppance. I like that much better than the kind of sleazy character who hits on everybody and people are just okay with it. They think it's fine. It's like, no, that's not fine. I don't like it. But seeing sleazy people get, you know, humiliated, I guess that's a trope, but I still liked it. I still would have liked it better than giving Jason a pass for hitting on Nancy and Deirdre all the time, even though they're clearly not interested. Let's see, Lauren was a very interesting character. I was surprised at how interesting she was. Even though she spent most of her time in her coffee shop, I thought she was really good. It was very atmospheric. That was nice. Tegan, mostly in the museum. That museum was not very interesting. And the upstairs area, I don't think was very useful. I think we got like one item from the upstairs area and then that was it. Yeah, I don't think they made the best use of the museum area. Definitely could have done that better. Whereas Olivia's shop, they didn't make much use of that either, but it was more visually interesting, fun to look at, so that was okay. Yeah, I think as I said, navigating outside was kind of a problem sometimes. Yeah. Spent a lot of time in the graveyard. The Hardy Boys were funny. It was interesting to see just all the characters team up, but as I said, the dialogue went on forever in this game, so some of the conversation scenes were overly long. Like the one with the Hardy Boys, Deirdre, and Mae. And Mae was only important for one of the conversations, so she's important for like 2 minutes of this 15-minute conversation, and the rest of the time she's just kind of sitting here like, okay. Yeah. And then Deirdre is half off frame there. That was kind of strange. Anyway. Oh my gosh, I've been talking for over 15 minutes. So, that was Nancy Drew, Midnight in Salem. Those are just my initial impressions. I'll probably play the game a couple more times and come up with an actual review as opposed to me just babbling on. I'll actually write something down in advance. So... I don't know what I'd give this game. I guess I'd give it, I'm thinking somewhere in the range between 6 or a 7 out of 10. Yeah, I think that's what I gave, like, Ghost Dogs of Moon Lake and Secret of the Scarlet Hand. Somewhere along the, I think that's what I gave them. I don't remember. It's been a while. So, yeah, I think I'd be comfortable somewhere around that range. We'll see if my score changes any when I replay the game, because right now my impression is, okay, well, about two-thirds of the graphics are good, and then one-third's kind of ugh, and then the dialogue is just... The dialogue, well, yeah, same sort of thing. It's like two-thirds of the dialogue I like, and then one-third is like, why is this going on forever? Way too much dialogue. Yeah, so... Those are my thoughts for the game. Do you have any different thoughts? Just leave comments. I'm sure people will leave comments saying what they think about the game. Thanks for watching. Thank you for putting up with my babbling about this game.